Praise be to God, IPC Hebron family. It gives me great joy to bring you this word of God on this Resurrection Sunday. We know the lyrics from this famous song. He took the cross. He chose to take the cross, shed tears for the lost, the broken and the needy, forgiving those who were and will ever be. The angels made it clear. He told them, have no fear. He's not there. He's not here. Here he goes, a hero, a savior of the world. Here he stands with scars in his hand. With love, he gave his life so we could be free, the savior of the world. Amen. We're glad we can worship him on this Resurrection Sunday, and the tomb is empty. This song reminds us that the empty tomb is proof that my Jesus lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, I know who holds my future, and life is worth the living. The power of resurrection means that nothing in my life has to be empty anymore. The empty tomb means that every aspect of my life can be rich, and he has made me resurrected with him. The empty grave proves that we have the victory over the curse of death, and sin has no more hold over our lives. And our lives does not have to be empty anymore. Yes, we go through many things in our lives, but we have that victory that we stand with the one who is victorious, and we have that resurrection power flowing through our veins as well. And we will learn about a church today, going back to the book of Acts chapter 11. We will learn about a church that put this into action, that exemplified this, that was a model church, the church in Antioch. So if you would turn your attention with me to Acts chapter 11. You know, if you obey Acts chapter 1 verse 8, which is the key verse, which says, go into the world and make disciples of all nations, then you will expect chapter 8 verse 1 as well. What happened in chapter 8 verse 1? It was persecution of the church, and Stephen was murdered or martyred, and we know that led to the scatter, and we know that all the apostles stayed behind in Jerusalem, but we know that the people in the midst, the Christians, mostly messianic Jewish converts that came to Christ, had to run to many different places, and some of them, when they went to different places, they spoke the gospel. And in the midst of their refugee experience, in the midst of their travel, they did not forget to tell others about Christ. And it's not just about evangelizing, but it's also about making disciples. So if you would turn with me to Acts chapter 11, verse 19 onwards, I'd like to read that for us. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except the Jews. So some of them were only speaking again to the Jews and not speaking to anybody else. But, the key word is but, there were some of them, men of Cyrus and Cyrene, who coming on to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists. I know we talked about Hellenists here, but here the Hellenists, the word is talking about the Greeks that were not Jewish. So these are the true Gentiles that they were speaking to. So they understood the true gospel, and they were speaking to the Greeks, not the Jews. So only some of them did this and started to preach the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. And the report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. We've learned about Barnabas before, and we see him over the many chapters, and he was sent to see what was going on, this great news that was going on in this city called Antioch. And he came and saw the grace of God. He was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. And for he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great number of people were added to the church. We see that Barnabas starts to minister among them, encouraging them, which is what he does. and the church starts to grow. And after a while, he realized that the encouragement was not enough, that they needed real meat. They needed the word of God. So Barnabas remembered Saul, and he went and got he went to Tarsus to look for Saul. We've learned all of these things, how Saul for 17 years is going through a crucible experience. He's back home in Tarsus, where he's just a nobody, but spending time with the Lord. And now we see that he had to go back and get, he was hanging out in Tarsus, and he had to go back and get him. And then it says, going back to that, it says, then Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. And the next portion that we see is some other things that are happening in the church in Antioch. And as we study this as a complete whole, it's important that we learn this as well. There was a prophet that came by named Agabus. And in those days, prophets came to Jerusalem from Jerusalem to Antioch. And one of them named Agabus stood up and showed by the Spirit that there was going to be a great famine throughout the land, which actually happened in the days of Claudius Caesar. And the disciples, each according to his ability, determined to send relief to the brethren dwelling in Judea. So the people in Antioch now, the ones that are called Christians, are the ones helping the original people in Judea and Jerusalem. This they also did and sent it by the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul. And just to finish this reading portion, because I will be going into it, we'll look at chapter 13, the first few verses. Now in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been bought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And they ministered to the Lord and fasted, and the Holy Spirit said, "Now separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work to which I have called them." And then after having fasting and prayer and laying hands on them, they sent them away. So we know up to this point that Great Commission has not come to its full measure that the Lord desired. We know that a couple of Gentiles, we've already talked about the Ethiopian eunuch, and we talked about Cornelius here recently, had heard the gospel. But there is no true Gentile church until this happens. And how did this happen? This happened by the people, the Jewish people, that were scattered by the persecution that was taking place. And after Stephen was murdered, except for the apostles, everyone else scattered to many different places. And some of them scattered to this place called Antioch. And we will learn many things about the Antiochian church here. Next slide. So just to learn a few things about Antioch, it was on this river, and today it is modern day Turkey. It was a big city, the third largest city in the Roman Empire, and had 500,000 people. So it was a very cosmopolitan or metropolitan city. In fact, it was a melting pot of cultures. There were people from Asia, Africa, and many places in Europe and the Middle East that would go through this because it was an important trade route. There were roads, waterways through that river, and many things that would take place. And there were 18 different ethnic groups that were living in this place called Antioch. So that's the background of the city. And when it talks about they, it does not talk about Peter. It doesn't talk about Paul. It doesn't even talk about any leader by name. All that's mentioned is they. The name of the people that started this church is not clearly mentioned in the Bible. You know, you think that telling others about the gospel and discipling others is the pastor or the apostle's job? This is counter to that. It said they. Who are they? The Cypriote and Cyrenaic converts came to Antioch. These were regular people that were going about their business. And in fact, they had left Jerusalem because of the persecution. So they were really refugees, or they were really people that were in journey. Their livelihood, their homes back home were lost. and now they are just living in the land. These no-name people are the they that are mentioned. And these no-name people that are called they are able to turn the city upside down and turn the non-Jewish Greeks' heart to the Lord, and for the first time create a true Gentile multicultural church. And the lifestyle that they had made the people, the pagans around them, call them a certain name. And we will go into that. Next slide, please. So I wanted to bring some general points in the story that we have read. The first point is that in the midst of their persecution, they still found time to tell others about the gospel. You know, although they were refugees, they could not keep the gospel to themselves. Their heart was overflowing with the gospel that they could not keep it to themselves. And we know that as a child of God, you will have many trials and toils and persecution upon this earth. So if you're waiting for the perfect time when you have no troubles, there might not be a time. And they, these Jewish people from Cyrene and Cyprus that came to Antioch, are a lesson for us that even in the midst of our trials, even in the midst of our persecution, we can tell others about the gospel and the saving knowledge of Christ. Point number two, we don't have to be an apostle or I guess a modern day pastor to tell others about the gospel. We think that it's sometimes, you know, it's our misconception that it's the pastor's job. And I just come to church on Sunday. As we heard last week, I'm just a consumer. What can I learn? And I'm just going to go about my work schedule, my school schedule. I got too many other busy things to do. And I'm just going to let the pastors deal with the evangelization. But it was overflowing out of these everyday they believers, ordinary people that were called them, not Peter, not leaders like Paul or Barnabas, formed the first century church. Yes, they had a part in helping them and enlarge it and making them solid in the word. But these ordinary people became the springboard for world missions. If you remember later, this is the church that sent out the missionary journeys of Paul and Barnabas. And again, in various missionary journeys, this church became the springboard for world missions. Point number three, once you believe in Jesus for your salvation, I think Pastor mentioned this last week, it is your duty to seek and find discipleship. It's not just to be saved and then say a prayer and believe that on the day of the rapture or on your death that you will be with the Lord. But you have to find yourself a Bible-believing church, find other fellow brothers and sisters, and find and seek that discipleship. And it also says the task of the church was to disciple people, make disciples of all nations, not just to speak the word and have some conversion experience as it is in the Western society today. So we are to not just be evangelizing the world, but to make disciples of all nations. Point number four, people that look different than you can be evangelized by you in a cross-cultural manner. And just because you might not know the language, they might look different than you, it is not an excuse not to evangelize your neighbors. As we live in a multicultural society today, as we work in a multicultural society here in America, we have people that work side by side with us that does not look the same, that does not speak the same language. And even in the midst of this refugee situation, as these people were running away, they had time to tell other people groups. 18 different ethnic groups were living in Antioch. It may be uncomfortable. It may be something that takes us out of our comfort zone, but it is something that we need to be doing, and the church in Antioch teaches us that. Point number five, that we need people like Joseph. It is Barnabas, the son of encouragement, that used his finances first. Remember, he had some property in Cyprus that he sold and gave to the first century church in Jerusalem. And then he got he's the one that spoke up and vouched for Saul and now goes back and gets Saul to help in the ministry and the word to build up this church. And he is also the one that follows up with the ministry in Antioch. And he's the one that goes out in missions from Antioch. So we need people like Barnabas's, the sons of encouragement in our church. When I looked specifically at this church, this was a model church that changed the world. In many ways, this is the first Gentile church. This is the first church that was involved in world missions. And so if it wasn't for the church in Antioch, I don't think any of us would be sitting in the pews that we're sitting in. We would not be in the situation that we are, because this was the first church that decided to go outside of the Jewish circle and tell the gospel to the world. And so there are some points that I learned from the church in particular. They shared the good news to the people that no one thought to reach out to. Amen. They were in a foreign land. They could have said, we have enough problems already. Why should we bother? And they were willing to reach out to the people that no one was willing to reach out to. And it just naturally overflowed from their heart. Point number two, it says that we are ready to disciple the ones that come to the saving knowledge of Christ. I already mentioned that, not just to evangelize, but the ones that come into the saving knowledge, we have to be willing to disciple them and be a true follower of Christ, that they can bring others to Christ as well. And that there was a sweet aroma of Christ that was emanating from this church, and this was known far, far away. The Jerusalem church got wind of the great things that was happening in Antioch, and they decided to send Barnabas over. So this church had a sweet aroma for Christ. How are we doing in that sense? Point number four, they were willing to accept and help and encourage, take encouragement from people like Barnabas. When Barnabas came over from Jerusalem, they could have said, no, that's fine. You guys are so insular. You guys are so ethnocentric. I don't need the help. We will take care of ourselves. But they had a humble heart that was willing to accept the help and the encouragement from Barnabas. They were willing to open their hearts to accept Saul. Now, the Jerusalem church had rejected Saul, and he was reviled, and that is part of the reason that he had to run away, and he was hiding out in Tarsus. But this church was willing to open their hearts to accept Saul, and Saul is the one that taught him the word for an entire year. They were willing to be taught in the word for 1 year by both Saul and Barnabas. So this was a Bible studying church. This was a church that was in the word and was taught by leaders like Saul and Barnabas. They were willing to extend their hands of fellowship to fellow brothers and sisters. When Prophet Agabus came and said, there's going to be a famine in the land, and it came to pass, they were the ones that put out their money and sent that money over with Saul and Barnabas back to Judea and to the original churches. So they had a heart to extend their hands to help the fellowship of brothers and sisters. They were willing to endure ridicule for Christ. And this is the first church that's called by a derisive name. Nowadays, we take this name as Christians with pride, but this name was first put upon this group as a derisive name, a name that says that they belong to Christ. And I will go into that a little bit more. Point number nine, they had the fivefold ministries in their midst. It says they had apostles, they had prophets, they had evangelists, they had a pastor, and they had a teacher. As we learn in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, they had all of the fivefold ministries in their church. Point number 10, they had fasting and prayer and anointing and ordaining taking place in their midst. We see in chapter 13 that they had fasting and prayer, and they separated Saul and Barnabas for the ministry, and they would anoint them and ordain them and send them out for missions. They were also a sending church that sent out missionaries, and we see that in chapter 13, verse 3. And the last point is they were led by the Holy Spirit. If you go back and read from chapter 11, it says the hand of the Lord was with them. The entire church was led by the Holy Spirit for direction and guidance. So the church in Antioch is essentially a model church that changed the world. It is the first church that all of our churches and all of us Gentiles, unless there is a Messianic Jew in our midst, that all of our history, our first church, can be traced back to the church in Antioch. Now, we might think, you know, the church in Jerusalem until this point, if you could put up that comparison, The church in Jerusalem that we've been studying up to chapter 10 was a church that was Jewish. It was monocultural. It was mixing the Mosaic law, such as circumcision. They had a narrow mind. They had stayed in their comfort zone. They had a superiority complex because they had all 11 of the disciples that were remaining. And so in opposition to that, this church in Antioch was outward focused. They were in a multiracial, multicultural, cosmopolitan city, as I mentioned, but they had a worldwide mindset. They were pilgrims or refugees, but they had a vision for the lost. They were submissive, and part of the reason is they did not have any of the original 12 apostles, possibly. They had Barnabas and Saul to teach them, and they were just ordinary people that were outward focused. We see in the emphasis of the ministry of the church in Jerusalem, it was seeking after miracles and signs and wonders. So it was a spectator mentality. While the church in Antioch had its emphasis on ministry, relationships, reaching out to the hurting people, and miracles were just a side effect. And everyone was involved in the church. It was not just some people involved, but everyone was involved in various ways as best they can help. We look at the resources that were there. We see that this church in Jerusalem, they had a grasping issue. They had money issues. We know about Ananias and Sapphira and how they lied about money. And we know about how they people would not be giving like they should. And some of the poor widows were complaining about food. But this church, on the other hand, the church in Antioch, were generous. They were sending out gifts. They sent out missionaries, not just in ordination, but the way it's written, it sounds like they sent them out with money as well. And we see that they were a giving church, planting other churches, and they were driven by the mission focus. The purpose of this church was also emphasizing the fivefold ministry and teaching and equipping the gospel outreach. And unlike the church in Jerusalem, there were murmuring saints complaining about everything. They would not accept Saul, where here they were willing to accept Saul and his ministry. Here the Jerusalem church had an attitude, what can the church do for me? Where in the Antiochian church we see, what can I do for the extension of the kingdom of God? What can I do to work together with the fellow saints that are here to extend the kingdom of God? So the attitude of the two churches are in stark contrast. You see the superiority complex and the poor growth, and they were focused on the physical circumcisions and rules and regulations, whereas the church in Antioch was willing to be submissive. They had a more organic growth. They had a true heart circumcision, and they had the right relationship with the Lord with an outward focus instead of the inward focus that the church in Jerusalem had. Guess which church was called the Christians? You know, when they were called Christians, it was not a badge of honor that they would wear. It was something that the people, the pagans of the land, called them. And it was something that they had a derisive name attached to them. This name was given to the Antiochian disciples by the pagans that lived around them. This was a term of ridicule that the disciples had to embrace with honor. It was a term of hatred and persecution. The literal meaning of it was slave to Christos, which means property of the Messiah. And that is what this 18 different ethnic groups that were stuck to their own kind, that would not mingle, and they, when the true gospel came to them, they started to reach out. And all the people were confused in the land. Why are these people mingling with each other? Because they had a different mindset. They had a goal that was under the banner of the gospel of Jesus Christ and not based on any other social agendas. Are you willing to bear this name of the Lord Jesus? As I'm concluding here, I'm asking the worship team to come up. You know, Roman law required that each citizen would pledge his loyalty to the emperor once a year. A citizen would have to pinch some incense and bring it to an altar and say, Caesar is Lord. But the Christians confess that Jesus is Lord, and the believers refuse to bow down before Caesar. And sometimes the Roman officials would write down the name of Christ on the ground or on the wall and ask the Christians to spit on it. And if the Christian refused, he would be arrested, tried, and perhaps even killed. And we know many of the disciples had to go through that as well. By bearing the name of Christ, it was not an easy thing like it is in the Western society today. They would be put to shame before their friends. But they were willing to bear this glorious name because it is a name higher than any other name. An anonymous writer once said like this, "Faith makes a Christian, life proves a Christian, trials confirm a Christian, and death crowns a Christian." Amen. By dying, our Lord Jesus, he destroyed death on the cross once and for all. And by rising again, he restored each one of us so we don't have to live empty lives. So Christ's resurrection teaches us, and it gives us hope for the future, that whatever issue you're dealing with right now, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. If you truly bear his name, we need to truly realize that we are resurrected with Christ to build each other up in faith and discipleship. But not only to build the other Christians up, but to tell the lost world about Christ. And not just tell them, but bring them into discipleship. We're familiar with the song, "By your spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I will come alive to declare your victory." Are you willing to bear the name of the Lord Jesus as the Antiochian church did? Can we examine ourselves? If the first century Christians in Antioch would look back and examine you personally or examine our church, would they find the qualities? Yes, many qualities will be found, but let us find where we are lacking and let us draw closer to a true gospel-centered, bearing the name of Christ, even in the midst of ridicule, kind of Christianity. May God bless you all with these words.